Good morning.
Good morning.
It's so good to be here with all of you. Welcome to Orange Congregational Church. My name is Kevin. I'm the student pastor here. Orange Congregational Church is an open and affirming member of the United Church of Christ. So no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. We love you, and we want you to be a part of this beloved community. We want to welcome back Ryan for our foreseeably final time with us. And I think it's very fitting that we give him a round of applause for all of the hard work that he has done for us. Ryan, you've been a blessing in this season of wilderness. With ever-shifting pulpit supply, thank you for being a semi-constant in our church. A few announcements. This Friday night, we will be having a movie night with all of our families and children, ages kindergarten through sixth grade. Y'all are invited to come watch The Prince of Egypt and the Pilgrim Hall. Since church school is learning about Moses this month, so if you or any or if you would enjoy The Prince of Egypt, you're welcome to come. Or if you know kids who would love to watch Prince of Egypt, please come out Friday night. This afternoon at 4 o'clock, we will be having our first in the Music on the Green concert series. We will be able to see and experience the beauty of the Ecclesia Ballet Company. And we would love to see you out this afternoon. Also this Friday is your last day to pre-order your apple pies for the holidays. This year, Victoria says they are inflation-proof, and they will still be $10. So please let Victoria know how many you would like, or contact Esther in the church office by Friday. She put that in all caps. So we would still like a few more contributions to the OCC Advent devotional book as well. So if you are interested in writing up a one page, or I think 200 to 300 word, little excerpt. It's a beautiful way for us to share our reflections on joy as we enter into this time of Advent together. Please, or you're even welcome to participate by contributing some art. We just want to see how we are reflecting on joy together as a community. So please have that in by November 17th. And I believe there's another announcement, Karen.
Good morning, everyone. For those of you who do not know me, I know it's a strange thought. my name's Karen McCausland, and I represent the Christian Service and Outreach Board. And we are hosting for Columbus House Welcome Kits. We are collecting items, and if you look in your bulletin under the announcements, there is a list of items that Columbus House is looking for. We are hosting this drive in honor of our own Chrissy Verhollick, who many of you know, whose love, and I'm going to cry, I'm sorry. Sorry, Mark. Whose love for the efforts of Columbus House and her compassion for homelessness, we felt, needed to be honored, so. Please give me a generous light. Thank you. Sorry.
Before I stop, are there any other announcements? Okay. Friends, welcome to worship. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please rise in body or spirit and join me in the call to worship. Lift praises to the name of our God. Bless God's name forever.
Our great is our God and the bright heavenly angels.
From generation to generation, we sing praises and speak of your goodness.
Great is our God and worthy of praise.
God is just and kind in all ways, watching over us in love and hearing the desperate cries of those who call out.
How great is our God and the bright heavenly angels. Bless God's name forever.
Inside these walls and online today. In word and song, and in prayer and story, the community of those who live around us are blessed by this church. Guide us to be blessings to our community, to be blessed by this community, and to focus on expanding the circle of your love. Remind us that we are one people, one in Jesus, one in the Spirit, and one in you. And hear us as we pray with one voice the prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Are deep and rich in emotion. So many of them are also steeped in incredible violence wished upon their enemy. And for almost the whole psalm, it's just about the joy of God in this psalmist's life. Hear these words. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. God's greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. The Lord is just in all ways and kind in all God's doings. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. God fulfills the promise of all who fear him. He also hears their cries and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless his holy name forever and ever.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Cindy Chandler, bringing greetings from the Music Board. Music is such an integral part of our worship services, both here and everywhere where people gather to worship God. Can you imagine a service where the organ remains silent, the other instruments are muted, and there is no singing? I certainly can't. Johann Sebastian Bach once said, "Where there is devotional music, God is always at hand with his gracious presence." The Music Board oversees the music program and all that it encompasses. Working closely with Brian, we authorize money spent to purchase music and musical equipment, organize and publicize the music programs of the church, and ensure the proper maintenance of the instruments we own. A big chunk of our budget is allocated for the expansion and repair of our magnificent organ. We are so blessed to have a talented organist who not only plays it beautifully, but can also diagnose problems that need to be fixed. As Brian and Kevin have mentioned, this year we are pleased to bring back the Music on the Green series of concerts, and our first concert is this afternoon. Much effort goes into these presentations, and there is a cost involved, which also affects our budget. They are not a money maker, but rather a way to bring the wider community together to enjoy some excellent music. We love to see all of you there, of course, but also others from outside our family of faith. Now, what would a music presentation be without some music? I'm going to ask you all to help me with my final thoughts. You may remain seated, but please join me in singing the last verse of "When the Morning Stars Together," which is a hymn found in the New Century Hymnal. The words are printed in your order of service. Brian will play a familiar tune that I'm sure you'll recognize. Listen carefully to the beautiful sound of the organ and our voices as we sing together such a meaningful text. Offer our gifts to all, but especially to the glory of God.
Our second scripture reading this morning, if you're just hearing it out of context, will sound like a bunch of gibberish that means nothing. So hang in there with me, because I hope we can make some sense of this, and it will actually, I think, speaks to our context very well. This comes from the end of the first chapter of a tiny book called Haggai, and a large portion of the second chapter. So Haggai was a prophet. He's writing to the people of Israel who have returned from the exile, which I'll explain a bit more in a moment. In the second year of King Darius, in the seventh month, on the 21st day of the month, the word of the Lord came by the prophet Haggai, saying, "Speak now to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people, and say, who is left among you that saw this house in its former glory? How does it look to you now? Is it not in your sight as nothing? Yet now take courage, O Zerubbabel, says the Lord. Take courage, O Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Take courage, all you people of the land, says the Lord. Work, for I am with you, says the Lord of hosts. According to the promise that I made you when you came out of Egypt, my spirit abides among you. Do not fear. For thus says the Lord of hosts, once again, in a little while, I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land, and I will shake all the nations so that the treasure of all nations shall come. And I will fill the house with splendor, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. The latter splendor of the house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give prosperity, says the Lord of hosts. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God. It is a joy to be back with you this morning. And as Kevin shared, this might be, hopefully, my last Sunday with you, because I have a candidating sermon on November 20th, which means if the vote goes well, I will be serving in a church full time rather than be able to do pulpit supply. So thank you for your incredible hospitality and journeying with me as we have done things like deconstruct Zacchaeus and now spend time in a book you've all never heard of. It's been a joy, and to share communion and so much more with you. Thank you. So in that theme of doing something new, I thought I'd try and preach from Haggai, which I've never done before. If I had called this a name that you'd never heard, would you believe me that it was a book of the Bible? How many of you actually think Haggai's in the Bible? Okay, good, good. Yeah, it's a real book. How many of you can spell it? How many of you can find it? I have to be honest, I started at the back of the Hebrew scriptures and moved my way forward because I know it's tucked between the two Z's, Zephaniah and Zechariah, and it's only two chapters long, so it's tiny and easy to miss. This little book at the end of the Hebrew scriptures only has two chapters. And hearing this scripture, you may be thinking, why do we need the Old Testament? Why do we need these little books at the end of the Hebrew scriptures? One of my parishioners at the church I served in Vermont, she had a pretty active campaign to throw out the Old Testament. That we shouldn't read it on Sunday anymore. Maybe we could use a couple pieces here and there for Bible study, but for the most part, throw it out. And she had some legitimate claims, which sounded like it's full of violence, it's full of sexism, it's full of patriarchy, it's filled with archaic legalistic laws. And yet my response to her was then, and is again this morning, is there is still more light and truth to break forth. And even in these texts that on the surface we don't know what to do with them, God is still speaking to us in very real and unexpected ways. Haggai is considered a minor prophet, meaning he's not one of the major prophets, which are Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. The designation is not so much about whether they were important, is it majorly important or minorly important. It has a lot to do with actually the size of the book that they wrote, but also where that book falls in terms of being centralized in our faith tradition, and Haggai has kind of a smaller role there. I'm sure you've heard pastors say context is everything. Context is everything with Haggai. Haggai is writing shortly after the great Babylonian exile. The Babylonian exile is when the Babylonian nation came into Israel and Judah, which was the land of the Israelites, conquered them, and sent most of the people away. Not everyone, but sent away. Certainly the leaders, the highly educated folks, the religious authorities were shipped out to other lands. Some folks, like farmers and things, were left to toil in the land. But this was the land that the Israelites had left Egypt to settle. This was the promised land, and they had been forced out. With Haggai, we find them finally returning. Life was beginning to begin again. The Israelites were getting back to something familiar. And then along comes Haggai. And he is laser focused in his call. He is challenging the people. Okay, we've been allowed to return to the promised land after exile. And many of you, both those who were exiled and those who were left behind to toil, have fallen away from your faith and fallen away from your faithfulness. And perhaps most important to him, perhaps at the center of this struggle for Haggai, is that there is no longer a temple. There is no longer a central place of worship. So where do you go to worship? Where do you go to find the priests? Where do you go to find God? We know that Haggai reminds us in verse 5 that God promised to be with the people always, no matter where they were. But this was actually a new idea for them. They had always centralized their worship. And there needed to be a center of Jewish life. There needed to be a place for the Holy of Holies. There needs to be a place that centers us and grounds us as people of faith. Yes, we are still God's beloved without a place to worship, but it is much harder. Without community, we are lacking. A life of faith is more robust, is enhanced, can grow more fully when we gather together. When we gather to worship, when we gather to mourn, when we gather to celebrate, when we gather to break bread. Oh, I'm sorry, for a moment I forgot if I was giving you Haggai's message or every Christian preacher today about gathering together after we have been spread out like the Israelites during a global pandemic, one in which we were not able to physically be with one another. one in which we long to desperately say goodbye to our loved ones in close proximity to the time of their passing, and to actually mourn that passing together, and to do so for each individual as well as on communal occasions of remembrance as we did last Sunday. Oh, and to gather at the table, to actually be able to share communion with other people. Sharing it with your family or those loved ones on screen is wonderful, but to actually be able to look at your neighbor, to look them in the eye and see the light of Christ within them is something profound and transformational, an opportunity to share the sacred sacrament. And please don't get me wrong, the incredible and outstanding heavy load that pastors and tech teams have done through the pandemic and continue to do is amazing and is vital to the future of the church. It is truly a gift from God. I would argue it's as revolutionary as pews being added to the church when you used to stand for 3 hours for worship to be able to sit for 3 hours for worship. It's that kind of transformation. And Haggai, all the while, also knows we need to be together and gather. We need to be in community. We need to be able to be physically present with one another. Our faith is an embodied faith. Jesus did not rise from the dead and say, "Look, I am a ghost." He said, "Look, touch me." So even after Jesus was crucified, the embodied nature of our faith was central to his ministry. Not to mention he preached and taught in person. He ate with people. He laid hands on them to heal them. And even some weird things like he spit in the dirt, turned it into mud, and then rubbed it on their eyes to heal them, because we are a people of an embodied faith. And we are a step ahead of the Israelites. As we return, we already have a physical building to which we can gather. So the question here for us is, how do we need to hear Haggai's call if we already have the physical building? To what is he calling us? I think there are some questions that follow from Haggai that sound like this. How do we need to gather in new ways and in deeper ways? How do we need to move out of our sleepy practices of faith that happened during the pandemic? I'll say that one again. How do we need to move out of our sleepy practices of faith that happened during the pandemic? And that's a really nice way of saying, what are the ways in which we have gotten lazy in our faith during the pandemic? What are the ways we let other things become central to our faith other than our love of God? What are the ways our community needs to deepen as a faith community? What are the aspects of our life together in which we forget God? We simply forget to acknowledge God's presence or bring God into the life and work of the church. Are there pieces of our ministry that happen that are centered more on humans than they are centered on God? Are there programs, places, and activities that are centered more on people than on the presence of Christ? These are the kinds of questions Haggai is calling us to wrestle with. Of course, he was doing so with a Jewish audience, but he is challenging them to not go back to how things were before, or to not just long for a dream of some distant past. Instead, he wants the community to realize that they have changed. Going through an ordeal, be it an exile or a global pandemic, changes you. It changes your faith. It changes the world around you. It changes the faith community. So he invites us. He prods us to dive deep into the deep end of the pool. It is time to walk out of the kiddie pool and be fully immersed in the community of God and begin the difficult and slow, challenging work of discerning. Who is God calling you to become? Where is God calling you in this new age? And how do you do that with even more faith, grace, joy, laughter, and love than you could have imagined only 3 short years ago? Amen. As we move into our time of prayer today, I would call to your attention a beautiful insert that is in your bulletin. If you have intentionally or accidentally turned on the news or looked at a newspaper in the last month or so, you're very aware that there's an election coming up in just a couple of days. And your community has put together an incredible resource, both with to educate on what are the possibilities, but also to help ground you in your faith. It's filled with scriptures to pray as you make your educated and faith-based decisions in this coming election. Will you be with me in the spirit of prayer? God of love and infinite grace, we give thanks that you have called us together this day, that you have helped us find ways to be safely together again. While the pandemic is not gone, we know that it continues to affect those in this community, our loved ones around the world, and we mourn for so many lives lost. We give thanks for the scientists and the researchers that have helped to make it safer to gather. God, we also give thanks for the flowers dedicated today in loving memory of her grandmothers, Alice Wayand and Catherine Clark by Susan Clark. God, we pray for two folks that have passed even since last week when we read the names of folks in our community, for Bradford Gessler and Nancy Stewart. God, we lift up names listed today for your care. Elizabeth, Harold, Ron, Shashi, Kathy, James Magner, and Glenda Pritchett. For Dorothy, Sheila, and Val. For Charles Wooden. For Terry, Brenda, Steve, Rebecca, Joshua, Russ, Sue, and Riley. For Rita, Betsy, Mary, Denise. For Irene and Robert. For Joshua. Loving God, we offer these prayers that are close to our hearts, these folks that we know in our lives, those that we have lost. We also pray for those around the world, for those places of conflict, for those places struggling to get food because of those conflicts. We pray that somehow your peace might wash over all of humanity, and that we might find new ways to live with one another and to be instruments of your grace. We pray for the ministries and organizations in our own community seeking to alleviate hunger, alleviate homelessness, to care for those who are struggling with mental health concerns. We pray for all those whose health concerns limit their abilities to embrace the wondrous lives with which you have blessed us. We pray that they might know your presence, your healing grace, and that they might feel your comfort always. God, we offer you all of these prayers and those prayers that are close to our hearts that we have not shared aloud, for you know the deepest longings of our hearts before we even put them to words. God, in your mercy, and let all God's people say, Amen. Those ministries of the church that we've heard for the last several weeks as we move through our stewardship time, but also how God moves in your life and how your heart and life are transformed by the infinite love of God's grace. Let us give with that love.
Thank you.
Gather at the table this day, let us pass the peace of Christ with one another. That can be a wave and a peace, a bump, or a handshake, whatever is comfortable as you pass the love of Christ. Know that God has heard your prayers and that you are forgiven. Know that you are loved just the way you are. Amen. Please be seated. As we gather at this table today, we are reminded that this is not our table. This is not my table. This is not your church's table. This is the table of Christ. The table has been set for all of us, and you are welcome no matter where you are on this journey, whether this is the first time you will come to the communion table or this is the thousandth time. Receive this gluten-free bread and this grape, the fruit of the vine, as a symbol of God's infinite love for you and God's unconditional forgiveness that God desperately longs for you to receive and to be made whole. Come, for all things are ready. Please join me in the prayer of the communion table. God, we know you are already in this space, for you are everywhere. Fill our hearts, open our minds and our hearts, that as we Receive the sacrament this day. We might know you calling us to be your beloved children more fully, that we might be instruments of your peace, that this table might be a symbol of your grace, and that in receiving this bread and this fruit of the vine, that we might be transformed in your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we gather at this table, we remember Jesus gathering with his friends. He gathered in the upper room. After having a meal with them and really journeying with them throughout his entire ministry, that so often gathered around the table, breaking bread with those whom the world said he should not. He took that bread, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave thanks, saying, "This is the bread of heaven given for you." And in like manner, he took the cup, he poured it out, and he blessed it, saying, "This is the cup of the covenant, poured out that you might have new life in me. Take and drink." As we share in our sacraments together today, I will invite you to take the bread of life and eat it as an individual, as a symbol of your individual beloved childness of God. Take and eat. You to find in your cup the fruit of the vine. Take it and eat it as a community, knowing that you are God's people. Take and eat. Let us join our hearts and voices in the prayer of thanksgiving found in your bulletin. Join me in saying, "We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ. Amen." Lord's Day, knowing you are a beloved child of God, called by name, seeking those places, God is calling you to go deeper and to make God's presence more known. Go in peace, and all God's people say, Amen.